Penguin Random House Audio presents The Best Cook in the World, Tales from My Mama's Table. This is the author, Rick Bragg. For the Cook. Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man. Colossians 4:6. Good stuff always has a story. Margaret Bragg. Prologue. It takes a lot of rust to wipe away a General Electric. Since she was 11 years old, even if all she had to work with was neck bones, pepper grass, or poke salad, she put good food on a plate. She cooked for dead broke uncles, hungover brothers, shade tree mechanics, faith healers, die shooters, hairdressers, pipe fitters, crop dusters, high steel walkers, and well diggers. She cooked for iron workers, Avon ladies, highway patrolmen, sweatshop seamstresses, fortune tellers, coal haulers, dirt track daredevils, and dime store girls. She cooked for lost souls stumbling home from Aunt Hattie's beer joint, and for singing cowboys on the AM radio. She cooked in her first 80 years more than 70,000 meals, as basic as hot buttered biscuits with pear preserves or muscadine jelly, as exotic as tender braised beef tripe and white milk gravy, in kitchens where the only ventilation was the banging of the screen door. She cooked for people she just as soon poison, and for the loves of her life. She cooked for the rich ladies in town, melting beef short ribs into potatoes and Spanish onions, another woman's baby on her hip, and sleepwalked home to feed her own boys home-canned blackberries dusted with sugar as a late-night snack. She pan-fried chicken in Red's barbecue with a crust so crisp and thin it was mostly in the imagination, and deep-fried fresh bream and crappie and hush puppies redolent with green onion and government cheese. She seasoned pinto beans with ham bone and baked crackling cornbread for old women who tugged a cotton sack, and stewed fat spare ribs and creamy butter beans that truck drivers would brag on 3,000 miles from home. She spiked collard greens with cane sugar and hot pepper for old men who fought the Hun on the Hindenburg line, and simmered chicken and dumplings for mill workers with cotton lint still in their hair. She fried thin apple pies in white butter and cinnamon for pretty young women with bus tickets out of this one-horse town, and baked sweet potato cobbler for the grimy pipe fitters and dusty bricklayers they left behind. She cooked for big-haired waitresses at the Fuzzy Duck Lounge, shiny-eyed pilgrims at the Congregational Holiness Summer Campground, and crew-cut teenage boys who read comic books beside her banana pudding, then embarked for Vietnam. She cooked, most of all, to make it taste good, to make every chip melamine plate a poor man's banquet, 'cause how do you serve dull food to people such as this? She became famous for it, became the best cook in the world, if the world ends just this side of Cedar Town. But she never used a cookbook, not in her whole life. She never cooked from a written recipe of any kind, and never wrote down one of her own. She cooked with ghosts at her sure right hand, and you can believe that or not. The people who taught her the secrets of Southern blue-collar cooking are all gone now. And they did not cook from a book either. Most of them did not even know how to read and write. Every time the old woman stepped from her workshop of steel spoons, iron skillets, and blackened pots, all she knew about the food left with her, in the way, when a bird flies off a wire, it leaves only a black line on the sky. It's all I've ever been real good at, and people always bragged on my cooking. You know, except the ones who don't know what's good, she told me when I asked her about her craft. When I was little, the old women used to sit in their kitchens at them old formica tables and drink coffee and tell their fortunes and talk and talk and talk about their sorry old men and their good food and the good Lord. And they would cook. My God, they would cook. And I just paid attention, and I done what they done. Most chefs, when asked for a blueprint of their food, would only have to reach for a dog-eared notebook or a faded handwritten index card for ingredients, measures, cooking times, and all the rest. I am not a chef, she said. Yet she can tell if her flour is getting stale by rubbing it in her fingers. I am a cook. I remember one night when she was yearning for something sweet. She patted out tiny biscuits and plopped them down in a pool of milk flavored with sugar, cinnamon, vanilla, and cubes of cold butter. She baked this into the liquid, half whole milk, half thick, sweetened condensed milk, steamed into the biscuits, infusing them with the flavors underneath. It created not a dense slab like a traditional New Orleans-style bread pudding, but little islands of perfect, sweet, buttery dumplings. The spacing, not the ingredients or the cooking time, was the secret here. Mama taught it to me, and Grandpa Bundram taught it to her, and his mama taught it to him. And, well, I guess I don't really know no further than that. In the roadside cafes, cooks in hairnets with Semper Fi on their forearms taught her to build the perfect burger from layers of charred, thin patties, melting cheese, rings of sweet Vidalia onion, and wheels of fresh tomato. They taught her crisp, fork-tender chicken-fried steak and how to dress steam foot-long hot dogs with homemade hot chili, just the right trickle of yellow mustard, and lots of finely diced onion to make the pulpwooders weep. She learned how to slow cook pork barbecue from old men who lived in the smoke itself. The working people wouldn't pay good money for food that wasn't fit to eat. I didn't make no money in a cafe. $14 or $15 a week was the most I ever made. But at Red's Cafe, we got all the pudding we could eat. Your Uncle Ed's mama, Granny Fair, waitressed at Red's when I was there. You remember her? She was kind of a big woman. Well, she'd bust through the double doors of that kitchen, snatch up one of them little chocolate puddings, and eat it in three bites on a dead run, and not miss a step. Her big sister, Edna, taught her to fillet catfish crappie and tiny brim with a knife as thin as aluminum foil. A brother-in-law, a Navy man, taught her how to pat out a fine cathead biscuit, but could only bake them a battleship at a time. Her mother-in-law showed her how to craft wild plum pies, peach, apple, and cherry cobblers, and cool banana puddings, all in pans as big as she was. Her daddy shared the secrets of fresh ham and perfect red-eye gravy and tender country fried steak. And her mama taught her to do it all, even with a worried mind. Then, finally, it was her time, and it has been for a long, long time. I have to talk to myself now to cook, she said. I have to tell myself what to do, have to tell myself to handle the knife by the right end. I have to call myself a name so I'll know to listen to myself. By what name, I asked, beginning to be concerned, do you call yourself? Why, I use my name, hon. I ain't so far gone I don't know my name. I'll say, Margaret, don't burn yourself, and Margaret, close the cabinet so you don't bump your head. It's when I do call myself by somebody else's name that y'all got to worry about me. Till then, hon, I'm all right. She had hoped for a daughter to pass her skills and stories to, that or a thoughtful son, someone worthy of the history, secrets, and lore. Instead, she got three nitwit boys who would eat a bug on a bet and still cannot do much more than burn a weenie on a sharp stick. and could not bake a passable biscuit even if you handed us one of those Whop'em cans from the Piggly Wiggly, and prayed for bread. We ate her delicious food without much insight into how it came to be, which was not all our fault. She banned us from her kitchen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.